Okay, so Shalom Ubracha. We're going to continue, hopefully, with where we left off and going into the details of Al-Narot Bavel, which seems to be connected to Mizmor, and we're going to show that. Before that, we can't now just avoid Purim. We have to go a little into Purim and connect it to the concepts here. Rav Nosen brings us down, and also this amazing sefer by this Rav from Mansi, Rav Rosenman, Rashi Besamim, where he connects every Torah in the Kutim Moran to Purim. So he says pretty clearly and makes sense that the idea that Haman had his 10 sons, Aser Bnei Haman, to go against the Yid, and he wasn't alone. He had Zeresh Ishto, there's Haman, and then there's the Aser, the ten sons. So the 10 sons, the Zohar says, why 10 sons? And they're so evil, and they were behind all the plots. Every evil plot that Haman did, his sons were involved. Besides Zeresh, his sons were also involved in stopping the rebuilding of the Beit HaMikdash, and also all the advice given, they were involved, you know, to try to get their sister to get him to marry to Achashverosh. You know, they suggested this idea of the Duz of the Na'arim. Okay, they're the ones who were trying to read bedtime stories to Achashverosh, and the wind kept on blowing the page, the Midrash says, and he said, what's written there? And it said there that Mordechai saved your life. He did a tova for you, right? So you have their involvement a lot in trying to do bad. So they say that the Zohar says that they correspond to what's called the Asara Kitrin Dimsa'avuta, the 10 crowns of impurity, which are evil forces corresponding to the 10 Sefirot. And by extension, now we're saying they're also against the 10 types of Nigun. Because Haman and his plot was to destroy the Jews. Destroying the Jews means to take all their chayut and their life force and their simcha and to bring that into the tuma. Okay? So because of that, the Midrash says, if you look at the Targum on Megillat Esther, it says there that on the night that Haman was getting ready, the tall pole, 50 amot tall, to hang Mordechai. So I think we mentioned this maybe last year. I don't know if you were here or whatever. That long stick, that long pole, came from the Ark of Noach, Tevat Noach. Okay. Besides that, that when Haman was getting it ready with all of his sons involved and all the workers involved, he was extremely happy. And it says there in the Targum, it's also in the Midrash, that the Aser Bnei Haman and Zeresh were all singing on musical instruments because we're so happy for them. This is the idea that they were trying to take the power of the 10 types of Nigun and to trap it into the Klipa. Because once you take the Nigun, which is the Tikkun, and there's no Tikkun, then you can obliterate the Jews. If there's no Tikkun and you destroy the Tikkun beforehand, which is the Simcha, which is the idea of them singing and bringing it into the Tuma, so this is how you can subdue the Kedusha. The pole itself was 50 amot tall. It was meant to hang Mordechai the Tzaddik on this. Rav Nosen explains the idea of hanging. It's called tliya. Tliya is also the word when a person is in doubt. He's talui. Talui, he's hanging. You know, you ask a person an opinion, he's like, it goes like this. When he doesn't know what to say, he makes a gesture. Like this or like that. The this or like that is hanging. It's a tliya. So Rav Nosen says that Haman, by hanging Mordechai, meant he wanted to implant a safek, doubt, into Mordechai the Tzaddik himself. Haman had the ability to do that because he, the Torah says, is rooted in the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Haman mina Torah minayin. Haman from the Torah, where do we learn it out from? Hamina etz. We went through this many, many times. Hamina etz. Hashem asked Adam and Chava, Could it be that from the tree that I told you not to eat from, did you eat from the tree of knowledge? So Haman, the sages don't know, Haman is hinted to in those words, Hamin, hey Memnu. So but what is that idea, that Haman is rooted in the tree of knowledge? That his koach, being Amalek, Amalek is gematria, safek, doubt. His ability is to confuse and frustrate people with not knowing what to do. Confusion. Is it this? Is it that? Like where we're going now in the world. There's media, there's fake media, there's fake media, the real media, and everything you hear, you don't know what is the MS or MS. In the meantime, people are dying. We don't know why. We don't know if it's everything is upside down. That's Amalek. What we need in life is this clarity. If you have clarity, then you know what to do. The problem is when you don't know the clarity. If you don't know what the real matzav is, if you don't know who your enemy is, then how could you deal with him, right? The miracle of Purim, where we wipe out Haman Amalek, is that there's no more doubts. Everything is clear. This is the enemy right over here, and this is the good over here. That's what we're looking for in Purim. That's the whole miracle of blotting out Haman Amalek. Haman, what he wanted to do, being the representation of this klipa of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, he wanted to implant a doubt into Haman, into Mordechai. So now, in the Sfirot, the Sfira and the Nigun, which is the antithesis of Haman and his pgam of the confusion of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, is Yesod and Maskil. So Yesod and Maskil, which is the Yesod, that's the foundation of the Brit of the Covenant, it's in that area. This is where he wanted to work to implant a doubt in Mordechai, and also by hanging him on a 50-foot tall pole, that everyone should see Mordechai hanging, it should implant doubts in the Jewish people also. It's not just to Mordechai, but everyone should have doubts. It's like Moshe, like the Asatan, the Havdil, to compare, or not the Havdil, but it makes sense as a comparison, what the Satan tried to do, and he succeeded in confusing the Jews by making the Aron of Moshe Rabbeinu floating in the air when Moshe Rabbeinu didn't come down at the right time. So the doubts and confusion and frustration implanted by the Jews, look, Moshe Rabbeinu's not here, what are we going to do? Haman wanted to do the exact same thing to get the people to believe there's no more Mordechai, there's no more Tzaddik, there's no more hope, right? So this was where he was attacking. He wanted to attack ten sons of Haman using a pole from Tevat Noach. Why specifically Tevat Noach? So we know already the whole pigam of the Mabul, the Zohar says, was kishchit kol basar et darko al ha'aretz, which was pigam abrit, wasted seed. That was the pigam of the Mabul. That's why the Mabul, the Zohar says, was hot and gopher. It was sulfur, the smell and the quality and the heat and water. Why that punishment? Because that was midah keneged midah for the pigam abrit that was very proliferant, unfortunately, in the Dor Mabul. And taking the wood, a pole from the Ark of Noah, and the Ark of Noah is the opposite of the Mabul. That means Noah was a tzaddik. His children, more or less, were all the animals and species in the Tevat Noah were tzaddikim. That was the idea. So taking the wood from the Noah, from the Tevat Noah, is that Haman wanted to be pogam in what was against the Mabul, what was the protection against the Mabul, which was Tevat Noah. To use that and hang Mordechai on that to show that there's no hope now. There's no protection. You can't hide now. To take Mordechai, hang him on the pole from Tevat Noach, okay? Plus with the singing and all the that night, there was a lot of singing, it says. And they were showing, there was illustrating, it's brought down, I think Rav Nosson wrote this book, Rashi B'Samim, that they were trying to take the power of the 10 types of song into the Tuma, so there's no hope to rectify anything. And if there's no rectification, he has full capacity to unleash his evil tuma, which is the tuma of the pgam of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. They get people confused and frustrated, and by that get people lost and trapped. Chas v'shalom. So this was the whole miracle, that he didn't know how great Mordechai was, and Esther. Mordechai and Esther are keneged Haman and Zeresh. Haman and Zeresh represent, if you want to say, the Samech Mem himself and Lamed Yud Lamed Yud Tav. That's why they say Zeresh Ishto was even worse than Haman, because she's Lamed Yud Lamed Yud Tav. She's representation. And Leumat Zeh, you have Mordechai and Esther, tag team together, that working together, Mordechai without Esther couldn't do it, and Esther without Mordechai couldn't do it. So they're the tzaddik and the feminine aspect of the Talmidah, the Talmid, the student, which is represented by Esther. The whole miracle was through that. So here is just in perspective of what we speak about. Hopefully next week we'll develop more the idea of the 10 Bnei Aman in detail, each one what they represented. There's a book I just found now, I'm going to try to go into it. It's called Dvar Be'ito, by a Rav who lived at least 150 years ago. It was printed in Livorno, the book. Dvar Be'ito, Rav Mordechai Sasson. So in this book, he goes into detail the midah, the quality, represented in the name of each of the 10 Bnei Aman and what they wanted to come to take away, what they wanted to come to destroy. What's Vaizata, what's Prashandata, which each one is, and what was the bad midah that they wanted to induce and go against. What good be that they want to go against, and with that you can know which sfira and which hopefully we'll get into that Bezat Hashem. With all that said, now we can connect this as an introduction to Al Narot Bavel. Okay? Al Narot Bavel, it's not mentioned explicitly in Mizmor, but Mizmor is hidden in the actual chapter in a most amazing way, in a few ways, Bezat Hashem. But for that, we need the Rekha, we need the background information from the Midrash and a little bit from the Gemara behind this chapter. Okay? The chapter was written by David HaMelech. How do we know? The Maharsha says a rule. Any Mizmor that doesn't say explicitly an author, so automatically it's David HaMelech. David HaMelech is the automatic author. He had Ruach Nevuah. The Melech foresaw what Bavel is going to do and what Edom is going to do. Okay? So that's why he's saying this, David HaMelech, before it actually happened. Al Narot Bavel. Okay? Bavel, if you look at Bavel itself, Rav Tzvi Cheshen, in one of his classes, he says, Bavel is like two times Lev. Bet, Bel. Bel is 32. Two times 32 equals 64. 64 is Gematria of Noga. Okay, Noga is the Klipa, which counters the Yesod. Noga is good and evil, tree of knowledge of good and evil. Maskil, Meshakel, like we went into many times, right? That's the song Maskil, or it's Meshakel, it bereaves. So it's Maskil or Meshakel, fine. So Bavel, that was their clip. That was the, they were the nation used to punish for destruction of the first temple, which then also there was Gilu Arayot. I think it was one of the things that destroyed the first temple was Gilu Arayot and sexual transgressions. So the punishment was to send him Dafka to Bavel. So the Jews said, Al Narot Bavel Sham Yashavnu. What does that mean, Sham Yashavnu? The army of Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuzaradan, they were instructed by Nebuchadnezzar. He said like this, we know that the Jews' power is in prayer. If they have a chance to daven when ready we take them leaving Israel, the Holy Land, if they daven, God will listen to them and just send them right back. So don't give them a chance to daven. There's a 15-day walk from Eretz Yisrael to Bavel, 15 days, the Chazal teach up. So they made them run very fast, and they have to sleep, obviously. You can't run straight 15 days, you'll die. It's a death march, if that's the case. And they wanted captives, they wanted slaves, okay? So they let them run, and when there was a break, they were so tired, all they had energy to do was just to eat quickly and fall asleep, and then wake them up early and let them run again, okay? So Sham Yashavnu, only when we got to Bavel, the Jews said, Sham Yashavnu, only then we had the opportunity to settle, which means Yishuvadat, to have settling of the mind. 15:15. Okay? Sham Yashavnu. Only there we had Yishuvadat. Only then were we able to think about what we did. Gambachinu, and then we're able to cry. So Yirmiyah and the enemies, they said, you Jews, you fools. If you would have, Yirmiyah said to them, the Midrash says, if you would have cried in Tzion while you're still in Yerushalayim, this wouldn't have happened. You didn't cry. Only now you're broken to cry. The Midrash says something else, more than this, that still there were Jews who still didn't cry yet. They needed something to cause them to cry. So the Midrash says, unfortunately, two other items caused the Jews to cry. That when they drank from the water, I think it's the Prat River, now Euphrates, I think it's the Euphrates River that runs there at the border of Bavel and eventually reaches Eretz Yisrael. That water was not healthy and clean like the water the Jews were used to drinking in Eretz Yisrael. Because the water in Eretz Yisrael was all Meimayan, was mineral underground well water, and it was cleaned, it was filtered, it was pure. So their bodies were very healthy because of the water in Eretz Yisrael. They came thirsty, drinking like crazy the water. More died drinking that unhealthy water than were killed by Nebuzaradan and the Babylonian soldiers in Eretz Yisrael. So Gam Bachinu, that caused them to cry. More than this, the Midrash says that Nebuchadnezzar was waiting with his entourage, with his soldiers, his ministers, and his important people on little boats in the Prat River, in the river in Bavel. And they're waiting to receive the Jews to mock them, to make fun of them. And Nebuchadnezzar, when he saw the prominent rabbis, Chachamim, of Yerushalayim, of the Sanhedrin, and the wealthy Jews, He ordered that they all be stripped from their clothing. They should be standing naked to break their morale. When he did that, he'd expected them to stand bent. But the Chachamim and the Askanim, the wealthy Balei Tzedaka, whatever you want to call them, of Yerushalayim, they still stood erect with dignity that were Jews representing Hashem. So he saw they weren't broken still. He ordered that they put on their backs a heavy, heavy weight in order to bend them. If they don't want to bend willingly, so put a heavy load on their back, that way they bend. So what did they do, the Bavlim? They took Sifrei Torah that the Jews brought with them. They cut them up and made big bags, big sacks out of the Sifrei Torah, filled them with earth, and put them on the bag of each one. At that point, these Chachamim started to cry. And when they started to cry, the Midrash says Hashem began to cry, and his angels couldn't handle seeing Hashem crying. So the angels, like Hashem made a statement, like something like, if they don't stop crying, I'm going to destroy the whole world to tohu vavohu. Like a similar with Rabbi Yishmael Yishmael Kohen Gadol, where they wanted to peel off his face. The same thing, the scenario. That Hashem said, if they don't stop crying, I'm going to destroy the world. So the angels tried to console Hashem. He said, when you think I'm a human being, that you can console me? I know what's going to happen from beginning to end. I can't take this consolation. Go down. Hashem ordered the angels to go down and remove the actual bags from the backs of the Jews. So when it says here, Gam Bachinu, we also cried. What does it mean, we also cried? It's not just crying. What was the first cry? Who else was crying? Hashem also and his angels were also crying. Bezochreinu et Tzion. In our context, Tzion is a reference to the Brit, Tikkun HaBrit. That we remember the damage caused to the Brit. That's what led to us to this difficulty. So at this point, it goes right to the Leviim. The Leviim play a major part of this psalm. Al Aravim Batucha Talinu Kinoroteinu. On the willow branches, which were growing out along, because they need a lot, willow branches need a lot of water. So along this Euphrates River was growing the willow trees. The Leviim, who were playing Kinorot in the Beit HaMikdash, they had brought with them the harps that they had from the Beit HaMikdash, five-stringed harps. They hung them on the willow branch. Why does the psalm tell us what type of a branch? You say, al etzim shebetocha, on the branches of a tree. Why does it say on what type of tree? Because the willow branch shows a total rasha. Ein tam ve'ein reyach. There's no taste, there's no smell. That's the aravot, the willow branch. They hung their kinorot specifically on the willow branch. They say there's nothing to sing about. We've been sucked of our ability to sing. So then, the next pasuk is giving us the reason for that, yeah?
So,
Arubah Gematria
Zera.
Arubah Gematria what?
Derech?
Zera. Zera, unbelievable. That fits in perfectly. Wow, the offspring. So the next pasuk, Kisham She'elunu Shoveinu Divrei Shir, V'tolaleinu Simcha Shiru Lanu Mishir Tzion. Because there, those who took us into captive, and the Midrash says, Nebuchadnezzar specifically, Shoveinu, She'elunu Shoveinu, those who took us to captive, asked us to sing the songs, right? V'tolaleinu Simcha Shiru Lanu Mishir Tzion. So the Midrash says, Nebuchadnezzar told the Leviim, who were there, they were prominent Leviim from the Beit HaMikdash, this is your homeland now. These are your idols. My idols are your idols. Sing to my idols the songs that you sang in the Beit HaMikdash. Okay? So more than that, okay? They asked us to sing Tolaleinu. One of the commentaries on Tehillim say, Tolaleinu is rooted in the word Yelala. And Rabbi Nachman says, Yelala is why she is called Lamed Yud, Lamed Yud Tav, because she's Meyalelet Tamid. She lets out howling sounds, which is like a sound of depression, but also a sound like when an animal eats, devours its prey, so it lets out this howl. The Klipa, Lamed Yud, Lamed Yud Tav, she lets out a howl when she succeeds in capturing holy sparks, holy children, holy seeds, holy souls of the Jewish people, and taking them into the Tumah. So in our context, he's saying, sing to us. Okay, similar to the singing of the 10 sons of Haman, sing to us your songs of holiness, so that Tolaleinu, our Yelala, the Klipa, Lamed Yud, Lamed Yud Tav, could be filled with simcha. We wanted to take the kedusha, which is represent. Because why is Nebuchadnezzar making such a big deal for the Leviim to sing to his idols? Because the singing, like we just said about the 10 sons of Haman, the 10 types of song is what transmits the energy of kedusha into the tumah. So tol aleinu simcha, feed our yalala joy by singing shirulanu mishir tzion, the songs of Tzion Yerushalayim, but the songs of which are the tikkun of Tzion, Tzion shir tzion. Okay, pay attention. We're going to this very soon. 5 times the word shir is mentioned in this psalm. Okay, kisham sheelenu shovenu divrei shir. Number 1, tol aleinu simcha shirulanu mishir tzion. The next pasuk. Ech nashir et shir Hashem al advat nechar. 5 times you have the word shir. Just keep that on the side, okay? So the next pasuk is the response of the Levim. The Midrash says the Levim said to one another when Nebuchadnezzar, who was on his ship, on his boat there in the river, he told the Levim to sing to his Levim in order to extract the energy of the 10 types of song to the Tuma. So they said to each other, the Midrash says, it's not enough that this midget, because Nebuchadnezzar was a nanas, he was a midget, like Paro was a midget, Hitler also was like a short midget, these would be short people. Nanas not just necessarily a midget, I mean someone short, very short. It's funny, there's a like there's correlation on these wicked people against Am Yisrael, they were all short, smart people, okay? So they said, it's not enough that this midget, this short little guy, he destroyed a Beit HaMikdash, he wants us to sing to his idols. So the Midrash says clearly that they strengthened, they had a courageous act of Gvura, which we're going to go into, and they bit off their right thumb. Specifically, the Midrash says, which finger? The thumb on the right hand. And once they cut off the right thumb, the kinnor has 5 strings. You need 5 fingers to play the 5 strings. It's true, when playing a harp, you use both hands. But the main hand playing the harp is the person's right hand. A righty, the one who's really playing and the one who's escorting, the left hand is playing the secondary tones on the harp, but the main tones is coming from the right fingers. If you don't have the 5th finger, you can't. So they were smart, the Levim. They didn't say, no, we're not going to, because if you say no, he's going to put them to death. So what did they say? We can't. We can't. Ech nashir et shir Hashem al advat nechar. You see, we're missing our right thumbs. Okay? The Midrash says afterwards that he found out that they did it purposely, so he killed more Jews. He didn't kill the Leviim. He was scared to touch the Leviim because he knew Leviim, we're going to the Leviim now, were a transition, were a bridge from the Kedusha to the rest of the world. We're going to go into this, the idea of the Leviim. So he didn't want to touch the Leviim, but the Israelim he killed. So it says, Tolaleinu, in a way, is like the result. They go on, on the word Tolaleinu, where it's Tilei Tilim, masses of graves of Jews were killed by Nebuchadnezzar. Okay? Fine. So the psalm goes on, Mishkachach Yerushalayim, Tidbak Rishonim, right? Ashei Shuchas V'nipetzet Olaichen Asala is the revenge. Fortunate, in another context, Ashrei is the Nigun, which is corresponding to Keter. Ashrei, the Keter, is the force that will take your children of Bavel, right? Nipetz, and will smash your children to the rock, because that was Mida Keneged Mida. And they say this happened both by Bavel and both by Edom, that they both, it's in Gemara and Gittin, Daf Nun Chet, it's very sad, that they said there were piles of brains of children, and that the enemy smashed their heads against the rock, and their brains came out, and it was a pile, and it's a machloket of how many? 9 kabin, 4 kabin, the Ben Ish Chai says 9 kabin keneged, that the Harugei Beitar did it, they lit candles on Tisha B'Av instead of mourning for the Bayit Rishon, so it's Bayit Sheni, this one, right? Instead of mourning for the Chorban Beit HaMikdash, they lit candles because they're happy for the destruction of Yerushalayim, because Beitar, they felt that they were more smarter, more prominent, and better than the Jews in Yerushalayim. So 9 kabin, 9 is a lot, big measurement of, it's more than a mikveh. Much more than a mikveh, of just brains of children. And that's what actually happened when Bavel, because it goes on Bavel also, because Bavel did this, besides in the Bayit Sheni, this pasuk is on what we just said now, is from the Tetch Kabin, is on Bayit Sheni, Harugei Beitar. But Nebuzaradan also did this. They were punished, that Bavel was totally wiped out. Mada and Paras, they left behind no one from the Bavlim. Nebuchadnezzar was killed, his offspring were killed, and all Bavlim were killed, and they were killed, and he forced Avram, David HaMelech foresaw this. Ashrei, fortunate is the nation, we're not going to do it, the revenge. We'll leave the dirty work to some other nation, which did it. Mada and Paras are the ones who took the Kasdim, took the Bavlim, and smashed their children's heads against, just like Mida Keneged Mida. The idea of smashing the heads, okay? Shochez v'nipetz et olalaich. The word olalaich is like we said the last class on Hodu. Hodu Lashem, kiru bishmo, hodiu v'amim alilotav. Olalaich is the word for children, right? Children, filthy, is the idea of holy sparks of children which are trapped in the tumah because they were wasted in vain. They didn't become actual physical children. They became demons, okay? So, Asher Shochez v'nipetzet olalaich, which are yours now, but are from us and are trapped by you, smashing them against the rock in order to extract the holy sparks back. So that's how it fits in, okay? So now, that's the mizmor here. With this, we can add a few ideas. The pasuk that Rabbeinu brings for mizmor, this chapter is mizmor, we're going to see. The pasuk Rabbeinu brought of mizmor, that the power of the song called mizmor is a tikkun abrit, is a pasuk from Iyov, Velo amar ayeh eloka osai, hanoten zemirot balayla. The person will not say, where is my God who made me, the Lord who made me? Who will not say this? The one who puts zmirot balayl, hanoten. Noten is with the hands, okay? So noten, with the hands, and zmirot is here a big hint to the hands of the Leviim who played the musical instruments. We're going to go into it. What we said on that class, hanoten zmirot balayla, it talks about anybody whose house has words of Torah heard within it. Hanoten zmirot balayla, someone who puts words of Torah to be heard in his house, okay? In Rabbeinu's context, he explains it, that when a person is trapped in the Laila, so the tikkun is anoten zmirot, you have to put mizmor, the power of mizmor, and that's what subdues the Laila, okay? But the act of mizmor, we went into this a lot. There's a machloket in the Zohar itself. One place in the Zohar, tikkun Zohar number 13, says that mizmor corresponds to chesed. Another place, and this seems what Rabbeinu is holding by, and this Michila goes against what Rav Morgenstern wrote in his Yama Chochma. In his Yama Chochma, he writes that this chapter, Anot Bavel, Mizmor is Keneged Chesed. But it seems, I'll explain why, more that it goes according to the Zohar and Pinchas. Because again, it's a machloket in the Zohar itself. One place the Zohar says it's Keneged Chesed, and another place it says the Mizmor is Keneged Gevura. It makes more sense that it's Gevura. Why? Because you see, Rabbeinu took five psukim from Tehillim to prove that the 10 types of song can subdue the Pgam Abrit, and five psukim from Iyov and Mishle. Of the five, you have two groups, okay? And those five and five correspond to what Rabbeinu says in Lesson 205. Then why we have to say 10 chapters of Tehillim? One of the reasons he brings is because the Da'at has what's called five chasadim, five gvurot, right? So five chasadim, five gvurot, we can assume the five chasadim are represented by the five psukim from Tehillim that Rabbeinu brought. We went into this a few times, that Tehillim, the Chida says, I think it's the Chida, that in the proper Hebrew it should be Tehillot. What's Tehillim? Tehillot is the proper way to say praises. The book of praises says Sefer Tehillot. What's Sefer Tehillim? Tehillim is masculine to indicate that it's all chesed. Tehillim is masculine, and the whole book of Tehillim is chesed. So he brings five sources of chesed, and those five types of song, which are from there, which are, we'll just go into that quickly, Bracha, Avrechet Hashem, Ashrei Nesui Pesha, Shir V'Laila Shiro Imi, L'Matzeach Al Tashchet, Ezkera Neginati B'Laila. Those are the five psukim Rabbeinu brings from Tehillim. Those five, which are Bina, Keter, Chochma, Netzach, and Nigun, they're all chesed, okay? And then Rabbeinu brings psukim from Iyov and Mishlei, which are dinim, which are hard books, and those other five nigunim, which has in them mizmor, the pasuk from Iyov, anoten zmirot balayla, so it's fitting that mizmor more goes to the side of gevura, okay? And it's hidden, we'll go into this, it's not mentioned explicitly mizmor in this chapter, okay? Similar to, I'm going off a little quickly, why Rabbeinu and the Kutei Maran all of a sudden throws in a Yiddish word You know, Sfardim are learning the Tikkun HaKlali. For the first time in their life, they see Kapitel. It says in the book, Likutei Moharan, Kapitel. How do you say in normal Torah language, chapters of Tehillim? Mizmorei Tehillim. Instead, Rabbeinu sometimes, Rav Nosson sometimes will say Mizmorei Tehillim, but normally they'll go to say Kapitel Tehillim. The Kapitel Tehillim, but there's probably a gematria here, but why the vernacular, why in Yiddish and not just say Mizmor, to show, just like Arnold Bavel doesn't say explicitly Mizmor, it's covered up, so to Mizmor in general, representing Gvura, we try to cover it up. We don't say it explicitly, we say it in Yiddish, a Kapitel, and not to say a Mizmor, okay? Fine. So, this being one of the, one of, Mizmor being one of the five of the Hegvurot, okay? Mizmor is, we explained, there's darkness and you make sounds of Torah heard in your house at night. That's the pshat. That means a courageous feat, similar to what the Levim did. First of all, the Levi corresponds to what according to the Kabbalah? Chesed is the Kohen. Levi is Gvura. Levi is Mizmor, his whole thing. He represents the Mizmor and Yisrael is Tiferet. Okay? So they did a courageous act. They bit off their right thumb. Now, according to the Kabbalah, there's many ways to look at this. We'll look at it this way. In Birkat Kohanim, when the Kohanim stick their fingers out, there's a mitzvah for them to stay. If a Kohen is missing a finger, he can't do Duchan. Duchan has to have all 10 fingers. Watch, this is amazing, okay? If we go according to the normal Seder, so the first pinky of the right hand would be Keter, Chochmah, Bina, Chesed, Gvura. Okay, and then you go down. Gvura, Tiferet, Netzach, Hod, Yesod, Malchut. We assume the right hand starts the 10th Sefirot. The 10th Sefirot would start from the right hand. You would not like Keseder now, Chesed, you know, the five Gvura, the High Chasadim. Let's go Keseder. If you go Keseder, because there's many ways to look at the 10 fingers of the Kohanim, and what they represent, the Sefirot. There's many ways of correlating. It makes sense. You have the Hei Chasadim, Hei Gvurot. But when the Kohen goes like this, there's a Seder. According to the Kabbalah, he has to go like this even. He has to like tilt it and stick out the fingers according to the Kabbalah. According to the Pshat, they have to make this. According to the Zohar, you have to open all five fingers of the Kohen. But the Seder is from here to here. The hand is Chesed. It's in other words, the beginning point is from the right pinky because that's the extremity, and you want to get down to the last pinky over here. So if that's the case, the finger they cut off was the finger corresponding to Gvura, the thumb. That's Gvura, and the song corresponding to Gvura is Mizmor. They took off Davka, and why they do that? It was a courageous act. That's crazy to do because it was a moon, to the extent that when Ezra, there's a whole machloket in the Gemara how to understand this properly, but when Ezra took the Jews 70 years later back to the Beit HaMikdash, he said, I found no Levim. Because he took all the Jews who were psulim, but taking with them back there, he said, left the totally clean Jews to stay in Bavel. Because if there's no supervision, he has to make sure everything is done right before he takes the Jews with him back there to Israel. So he says, even from the improper Levim, there were none. Why were there none? Because they had cut off their thumbs. Right? There's a machloket. Is a Kohen who's over 70 years old on how to play music in the Beit HaMikdash. So there's a machloket, yes. They say a Kohen not allowed. This is a whole pilpul, just on the side. A Kohen that is missing a finger is considered a chisaron rokin oil moed in the Mishkan in the desert. But for the by Beit Olamin, if he's missing a finger, you know, the Levi's missing a finger, so His being old. I made a mistake. The Shanim Poslim. There's an Indian of Shanim Poslim. So the Machloket is that if he's 70 years old, which means his voice is cracked now, he's very old, can he still do work in the Beit HaMikdash? The answer is in Beit HaMikdash, yes. In Mishkan, no. If he was in the Mishkan, he's 70 years old, he couldn't do, it would be a puzzle. But in the Beit Shani, he would go back to sing. So he's saying, right, finally, Levi'im, because they were missing their fingers. And that was already a psul. You would think, okay, if they're not missing their fingers, they can sing. He said, no, the fingers is what's ma'akev on the, which stops for the work in the Beit HaMikdash. That's what Ezra, that's the whole Gemara there. It's a Gemara in Yevamot, a Gemara in Kiddushin. Fine. So now, of all this, Zmirot, the attitude of Mizmor is Gvura. And the attitude of Gvura is that a person is courageous. Or a person is standing up to do something for the sake of Hashem. That is the attitude of the nigun called Mizmor. That's the attitude of the Nigun called Mizmor. Okay?
Mizmor also means to cut off.
Lezamer. Lezamer, exactly. Lezamer, it means to cut off. That's why they cut off. Because to do a courageous act, which is painful, but it's a benefit. The Midrash says that they were happy in the end that they did it. The Levi'im were so happy they were able to sanctify Hashem's name and not do the Avodah Zarah. They were happy. They didn't cry over it. It was their consolation. So you see that they won. Their attitude was Menatzeach and won in the end. Rav Nosin has a big, big section in the Kutei Halachot, Hilchot Ishut Gimel, where he goes into the whole secret of the Levi. The Levite is the whole channel of Nigun. He's the whole channel of melody into the world. That's why the Levi'im would play the music in the Beit HaMikdash. And Levi, music, is what connects the rest of the world to Hashem. There's what's called the Kol HaYashar, the direct voice, and it's what's called Kol HaVara, an echo. Echo today is, in other words, a means of an echo to connect you to the direct voice of God is Nigun. That's why Nigunim in Judaism and Hasidim is something so powerful. Because Nigun, if it's done properly in holiness, can reconnect a person to the root. But in itself, it's an echo. In itself, it's just using the tunes of this world and making a beautiful melody. But the Levi'im, with their intent to connect people with the Nigun to the Kohanim, which represent the direct voice of God, that's the symbolism of Chesed of the Kohen. So the Levi'im had to be sanctified to such a degree that their music, even though it's coming from this world, it's using the air of this world, pressing on keys with the air of Olam Hazeh to make a melody to help connect a person with the faculty of the Medameh, the imagination, to connect the direct voice of God. So that's why Nebuchadnezzar wanted to attack the Levi'im. That's why the Tikkun of Tikkun HaKlali involves melody. Because Nigun is like, you see, in between Kohen and Yisrael are the Levi'im. So Rabbi Nachman's Tikkun, the Tikkun HaKlali, is now this thing which is the interface between the Kohen, which is like the goal. Kohen is someone who's cool, or he's always is attached 100%, he's in the Kedusha, etc. And then you have the Yisrael over here, the Am Yisrael, and you have the Levi in the middle. We still have some time? Okay, so one more Chiddush now. This I should say next week, but watch this. This is something amazing to show Rabbi Nachman's Seder and how he picked the actual 10 chapters and why this order. So let's go again to the order. The first chapter is Tetzayin Michtam LeDavid, which corresponds to Bracha, which corresponds to Bina. Okay? Second chapter is Lamed Bet, which corresponds to Ashrei, because that's the Pasuk there, which corresponds to Keter. Right? Mm-hmm. Number three is chapter 41, which corresponds is Maskil. And fine, Maskil is Yesod. Like we said, he goes down all the way. Fourth one is Membet, Ke'al Tarog. That's Shir, Ubalayla Shir Oimi. That's Chokhmah. Okay? And then after that, we have Nuntet, which is Nitzuach. Nitzuach, and that's the sphere of Netzach, obviously. And then after that, we have Ein Zayin, which is Nigun, which let's say still that it's Chesed. Okay? And then you have, after that, you have Tzadik, Tfilah, Tfilah Le Moshe, Tfilah, which is Malchut. Okay? And then you have Kuf He, Hod, Hodu, which is Hoda'a or Hodu, which is Hod. Okay? Did I miss anything? No? And then we have Kuf Lamed Zayin, this chapter, Anod Bava, which is in it hidden Mizmor. Ah, I didn't finish. What the last thing? Shir is five times. Okay? You know, let's say this first, and then after this, remind me, because it's connected to this. Okay? Well, this is the spitz. The chair on top is the five times shir, and where Mizmor is hidden in here. So Kalaz, Kuf Lamed Zayin, is Mizmor. Okay? It's hidden in there. And that's Keneged Gvura, let's say. Right? And finally, Acharon Achon is Kuf Nun, which is Halel, which is Keneged Tiferet. That's the goal. Okay? So then Rabbeinu says that these 10 are also broken down into the Shir Pashut, Kaful, Meshulash, Meruba. So let's do that. The first chapter, Bracha, is 1. Second one is again 1, because it's 1, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4. So Lamed Bet Ashrei Keter is again 1. Mem Aleph Maskil Yesod is 2. The fourth chapter, Shir, is now again 1. Right? And then Nuntet is 2. Ein Zayin, Nigun, Chesed is 3. And now we go back in Tzadik, we start again, one, Mirubah. So Tzadik, Tfilah, Malchut is again one. Kufei, Hodu, Hod is two. Anod, Bavel, this chapter is three. And finally, Tiferet, Hallel, Kufnun, Hallelujah is number four. So now take these groups. So you have four that are one, three that are two, two that are three, and one that's four. Put them together now. The ones that are one are under one. We have in the spheres, it's Bracha Bina, Tetzain Bracha Bina, that's a one. Keter, Lamed Bet, Ashrei Keter is another one. Okay. Membet, Shir, Chochma is another one, so Chochma. And then Tzadik, Tfila, Malchut is another, Malchut, Malchut, that's all the one. In Kabbalah, you have the Mochin, Keter, Chochma, Bina, and Malchut. You have that sometimes, okay? This is the first group. Mm-hmm. Number two, the twos, the Kaful is Yesod, right? Mm-hmm. Mem Aleph is Yesod, okay? And then you have Nuntet, Nitzuach, Netzach is the two. Mm-hmm. Netzach, okay? And then Kufhei, Hodu, Hod is also a number two. So you have Hod. Netzach, Hod, Yesod. Okay, Nehi. All right? Third group, which are two, is only Chesed and Gvura. Nigun, Ein, Zayin, Nigun, Chesed. That's a three. And also Kalaz, Mizmor, Gvura is also a three. So you have Chesed and Gvura together. Mm-hmm. And finally, number four is Tiferet by itself. Okay? Mm-hmm. It fits in. All right. So now, in this chapter is mentioned five times Shir. Four, we can understand that they correlate to the Shir Pashut, Kafun, Meshulash, Merubah. He wanted to take, in Nebuchadnezzar, the whole power of the 10 types of Nigun. So it says there, five times Shir. Five times is, you have four, is the Shir Pashut, Kafun, Meshulash, Merubah. What's the fifth Shir? I don't know if we were together for the Shir for Hanukkah. No, we weren't. We did a preview. The Zohar says, whenever in the book of Tehillim it says Mizmor Shir, it refers to a double Shir. It's like, you know, you can't say, you know, instead of Mizmor Shir Leom HaShabbat, Shir V'Shir Leom HaShabbat. You don't talk like that. Or Mizmor Shir Hanukkah Tabayit David, which is the capital for Hanukkah. That's why I went into it. So Mizmor Shir, you don't say Shir V'Shir Hanukkah Tabayit David. Mizmor Shir, the Zohar says always, it's a rule throughout the book of Tehillim, is a double Shir. So you have the first initial shir, Pashut, Kafur, Mishulash, Merubah, and the fifth one is the double shir, which refers to Mizmor. So Mizmor is hidden in this chapter, because shir and Mizmor, even though Mizmor is Gvura, but just like El Elokim, the two names of Chesed and Gvura, you have Kel, Aleph Lamed, and Elokim. In Elokim, you have Aleph Lamed. The part of Chesed is feeding Bigvurot, Yesha Yemino. In the Gvura is the salvation of the Yamin, of the Chesed. So in the Gvura, Elohim, you have Aleph Lamed also. So to Mizmor, we said in the Zohar, it has Raz, Mum. If a person Zocher, so the Mizmor reveals to him the Razeh HaTorah, the secrets. And if not, it's a Mum, okay? So just like in Mizmor, you have the Chesed side of it, the Raz and the Mum. So the Raz part of the Mizmor is connected to Shir, Chochma, the Shad Chochma leading to that. That's just how we see it's hidden into that. So what comes out of the Maaseh is this chapter has hidden in it the format of Mizmor, and it's hidden, just like Mizmor is called Kapitel. We don't say Mizmor Teilim. Even Sfardim, we say Asara Kapitel Teilim Elu. In the Tefillah of Nosim, we say Kapitel. It's a prayer in Lashon HaKodesh. If a Sfardi guy is saying Kapitel, he knows what Kapitel is. It's referring to Mizmor. Why do we say, just say Mizmor? Rav Nosson, it's so difficult to say Lashon HaKodesh. You have a whole prayer written in Lashon HaKodesh, you have to throw in words in Yiddish? Yes. Mizmor has to be covered up because it's Gvura. It has to be covered up. There's something in Kapitel. I didn't go into it. The Gematria of Kuf Pei Yud Tet Lamed. There's something here in the Gematria of Kapitel that hints to the idea of Gvura, the idea of Mizmor. We'll go into that Bezat Hashem. But for now, that's now what comes out of this is Gvura. Mizmor is the strength to have courage to stand up. Until now, we didn't find the chapter that gives a person courage. We have one that gives a person self-confidence and this. But now courage to stand up and do something which will be a seemingly loss, but will be a benefit, that's Gvura. That's what Gvura is. And the Levi'im exercise their Gvura by cutting off their finger which represents them, which is the Bohan, the right thumb, which represents what they're doing. Because again, also, the right thumb is separate from the other four fingers. it's as if the fifth finger, the thumb, is misharet, like a levy, the other four. It's serving. The thumb helps for the other four, right? You hold a pen with the fingers and the thumb in a way, you see, it gives it the final. If I hold with my fingers, fine, but I need the thumb to escort to doing it. Always in music also, the thumb will be the one to do the escorting. It's like, it's part, but it's serving the other four fingers. That was the levy. They cut off the thumb, which represents them, themselves, the idea of Gevurah. Shem Yazar, that was that for now. Yeah. Everything is the Bohan.
The boy Yodov,
right.
They put a shaman because some Torah is Din and it's Gemurah.
So they put it on the
Dafka. Shem
and they put it on the right on the thumb. Right. You would think to put it on the left thumb if it's Gevurah, the Mitzorah. But the Gevurah Yeshay Emunah. Shchazan, Chazak Baruch. All right.
Beautiful.